Imagine you could step inside the minds of Canada's healthcare leaders, glimpse their greatest fears, strongest drivers, and what makes them tick. Welcome to Healthcare Changemakers, a podcast where we talk to leaders about the joys and challenges of driving change and working with partners to create the safest healthcare system.
Welcome to Inspiring Impact, a special series from HIROC and Advantage Ontario. I'm Ellen Gardner with Philip D'Souza. This is our fourth episode in the series, and today we're delighted to welcome Jennifer Cornell. Welcome to Inspiring Impact, Jennifer. Nice to have you.
Thanks so much, Ellen. It's really great to be here.
Can you tell us a little bit about where you work and what you do there?
Sure. I work for the County of Grey, which is a municipality in southwestern Ontario. The county operates three long-term care homes. We have 150 residents in Owen Sound, 100 residents in Durham, and 66 residents in Markdale. And I lead and support the teams in the homes as the director of long-term care.
How long have you been there?
I have been with the County of Grey just over 10 years, and I've been in the role of the director since October of 2019, so just before the pandemic.
We know that you recently presented at the Advantage Ontario Annual Convention. What was the focus of your talk, Jennifer?
I participated in two presentations, actually. One was a partnership with Ontario Caregivers Organization, Briere, CLRI, and Grey County, and we talked about our experience supporting essential caregivers. And the other presentation was a fireside chat with our staffing partners, and we were just chatting about how we worked with our external partnerships in Grey County to support our staffing levels through the various waves of the pandemic.
Was there anything surprising or really interesting to you that came out of that fireside chat?
There was lots of questions about, you know, how did we look outside the box and how did we use innovations? And really, it just highlighted for me the importance of our color it your way approach. And those are our words for resident-centered or person-centered care. And we've started expanding that to not just the resident experience, but also to the staff experience.
That's something that you had brought up to us a couple of weeks ago when we spoke, and we're very interested in this model of care. So maybe you can tell us how you came to adopt it, where it comes from, a little bit about the model.
I love talking about Color It Your Way. So Color It Your Way is the tagline for the County of Grey. And it came into being around 8 years ago, 8 or 9 years ago. And it also became the promise that we make in Grey County long-term care. So as I said, it's our words for person-centered care. And through the engagement of residents, staff members, stakeholders, partners, we imagined what person-centered care meant to people. What does it mean to you? What does, if your experience at Grey County long-term care was perfect, what would that look like? And we actually drew some pictures and did some engagement to vision what that is. And we came up with an acronym for Color It. So C is community, O is for opportunity, L is for leadership, O is organizational quality and safety, U are the center of all that we do, R is for relationships, I is integrity, and T is into tomorrow. And it's really these words that give us a foundation of how we support our care communities.
If I was to walk into one of your homes and, you know, see that you'd transitioned from an institutional model to a resident-led care approach, what would look different to me about that facility?
I think it's maybe less about how it would look and more about how it would feel. And so one example is, we applied our Color It promise to the admission process. And we think about our language and we think about what happens when someone is admitted into long-term care. And our team members said, really, you're not admitted into long-term care. You move in. So we've changed our language. It's our Color It Move In. And we ask questions of the resident, the individual moving in, and their support network, so their family or their friends. And we ask them questions like, what does community mean to you? What relationships are important in your life? If something doesn't go quite right, how do we approach that with integrity? How do you want to live your life into tomorrow? And so we use the Color It language and the Color It acronym to ask meaningful questions to make sure that we're providing the care and the services that are meaningful to that individual.
What's it been like in terms of your leadership team and, you know, and frontline staff in terms of embracing this model? Maybe talk a little bit about how it actually got implemented.
It's really a shift in thinking and a shift in culture, and that takes time. And so as a leader, as many of us are, I'm impatient. And so, you know, we want to see change immediately, but it takes time and we need to be noticing the changes as they happen and paying attention to that. So as I mentioned, this was 8 years in the making, and it's really, people knew about it because we talked about it. So while it's been happening for 8 years, there's still work to be done and opportunities to bring about positive change. So our leaders right now, we're looking at how do we expand the Color It philosophy from the resident experience to also include the staff experience. So when we're looking at our orientation and how do we color it orientation, when someone starts in one of our care communities, do we create a sense of community? Do they feel like they have opportunities? Are they getting good leadership? Are they feeling safe? Do they feel like they're valued and they're appreciated? It's something that becomes a part of how we talk and how we approach basically every change, every initiative, every quality improvement opportunity. And it's just in doing that consistently and intentionally that it becomes known and it becomes a part of the fabric of the organization.
As the leader of the organization, you have an important role to play in, you know, in believing in this process and helping other people believe in it. What's been personally fulfilling for you in seeing this happen?
There's so much happening in our sector in long-term care right now, and there really always has been, and it's just been accelerated by the pandemic. And, you know, over the past year and a half, so in a new leadership role, in a pandemic that was just filled with the need to have to make, you know, some pretty tough decisions and some pretty quickly, I found and continue to find the Color It model and that framework really helpful in taking a step back, taking a breath, and thinking through what are the options, what are the decisions to be made, and how can I use Color It to help make a person-centered decision. You know, we've added a couple of questions in our Color It framework in our senior leadership team when we're making any sort of change or change to policy or adding a new program. The three questions that we reflect on: does this color it? So does it meet all that criteria? Is it leading practice? And is it equitable and reliable? And by equitable and reliable, we recognize that all three of our care communities are in unique cities and towns, and they have their own unique features. So when we're applying a change, do we respect and allow that uniqueness to shine through? And when it's reliable, when we implement this change, can we reliably expect the outcome that we're hoping for on a sustainable and consistent basis?
At HIROC, we've talked to leaders all year, and what we hear is that it's been a challenging time for leadership just because, you know, you had to make so many new decisions, you had to make them quickly. People were turning to you in ways that you hadn't had before, maybe, and especially for you being new in the job. Where did you find the support and the strength? I know it does sound like you found it in Color It, but you know, were there other ways that you found strength just to kind of, you know, feel like you were able to cope with all the things being thrown at you?
The long-term care sector is a really caring and compassionate and innovative and helpful group of leaders. And when you reach out and say, hey, I'm not sure how to handle this, someone responds. And so I think it's really in reaching out, and we call it call a friend. So we would do virtual updates for our families and communities, virtual kind of COVID updates as things were changing. And I was the host of the update, but I was just the spokesperson. So someone would ask a question and I'd say, well, I'm going to call a friend. Let's throw that out to the teams. And, you know, my phone would light up and lots of team members would text me back with the answers. And that became just part of what's expected. We don't need to know all the answers in leadership. We just need to know when to ask and to ask for help, and we'll get it.
Do you have any thoughts you want to share on how County of Grey has been managing the staff shortage?
I did reach out to the homes in preparation for this discussion to say, hey, can you share some scenarios with me and some of your color it stories? Because we intentionally look for color it stories so that we know when to celebrate and take a moment to do that. And the theme that came back from all three homes was in acknowledging that the pandemic is hard for the long-term care sector and the organization, but also for each of us as individuals. And many of our team members were really struggling, just like we were, with childcare, virtual school, and having some of that conflict with our regular scheduled work hours. And what the teams in the homes did was say, okay, they looked at it on a case-by-case situation. What could we do that's flexible? How could we support both needs? And many times staff flexed their start time so that they could still support their kids at home and then also still fulfill their commitment at work, just starting at a different time. And so we really took this very flexible approach, and it worked out.
If a healthcare organization wanted to implement something similar, you know, they looked at your homes and saw what you'd done and you were giving them some advice, what would be one or two things you'd say that they should be thinking about?
I think getting clear on your purpose and on your vision. What is it that you're trying to achieve as an organization or as a care home or a facility? And then go out and start talking to people and getting curious about what that means to them. So if you have a mission statement and a vision statement, dust it off. If you haven't brought it out in a while, dust it off. Start saying the words and seeing if that really resonates with people, and use the words a lot. I really think it's just approaching the conversations from a place of valuing and appreciating people and determining what is the standard and how do we hold the standard, and ask lots of questions. People will tell you when you ask them.
I like the idea of continuing to ask questions and evolving, you know, not being afraid of change.
A coach that I've worked with for years told me a long time ago that, you know, there's this misconception that we don't like change. And if that was the case, we would never get our hair done and we wouldn't buy new shoes. So we do like change, but you're right. It can be uncomfortable. And I think it's when the change is outside of our control, that it's really it's scary. So if everyone's engaged in discussing what the change looks like, it makes it a much more comfortable process.
How have you looked after yourself this past year?
Yeah, you know, I feel like I'm not alone in maybe not taking enough time to do some reflection on that. I think leaders in long-term care especially have been in, you know, response mode and care mode for 15, 16, 17 months. And I do think that we need to take, that's not sustainable. We need to take a minute to take a breath. And So I do depend on my colleagues to give me a nudge and say, hey, you've suggested I take a break. I think maybe you need to take a break too. And really just respecting that as coming from a place of caring and compassion. And we need to do that for each other. So, you know, I do download Audible books, and I try to get out for some walks and listen to some fiction as a chance to kind of get away and take a break. But I think there's opportunity for all of us leaders in healthcare to maybe make some plans for the summer to take some time off.
I really appreciate the fact that that part of the Color It program, the model, you know, quality and safety is that's something that we truly value as part of our vision and mission at HIROC. So it's so true when you talk about having that, you know, that North Star and making sure you remember and say it. And I love also the call a friend model. That's something, you know, as a reciprocal HIROC, which HIROC is, we see our subscribers calling one another. You know, they call us, of course, as well. And then we provide that guidance and say, we provide it to one subscriber. They, you know, they're more than happy to share that guidance with others so that, you know, because we're all, you know, we're all in that same, all of our subscribers are going towards that same goal of, you know, of to turn the corner on patient safety. So yes, my question about the shift in thinking is, how did you, you know, did you, along the journey, was there any apprehension from staff or leaders or anyone involved in the implementing it that, you know, you had to, you know, communicate more or go a different, you know, pivot a bit and go a different route to share the value in the colored model?
Absolutely. I mean, it took time. And for some people, this felt a lot like rainbows and unicorns. And, you know, it was really, I said color it a lot. So I decided early on that the person that invented Nike's Just Do It didn't say it two or three times and put it in an email and then it just took off. They probably said it 53 times a day, and people probably rolled their eyes at them until it became a thing that now when you say just do it, everybody knows that's Nike. And so I took that approach. So of course, you know, I got a few eye rolls here and there. And it was really just in how do we apply this to the everyday situation? So you're having this challenge. Let's use color it. How is this? Maybe we had a color it missed opportunity. What could we do differently? How did this actually give this person a feeling of being the center of all that we do? And once we started having conversations with questions that were really, you know, specific to that scenario, people started to see, okay, I can see how this applies. I can see that this isn't just words, that this is more than that.
What's next for the color it model as you continue the journey? Like, do you see it transitioning? Do you see it changing? And I guess my follow up would be if any of our subscribers or listeners today wanted to implement it, can they reach out to you, or is there like a resource that they can, or something they can go to, like a website or something, or a book, et cetera?
It's ever evolving, and Gray County Long Term Care is we're in the process of implementing a 2-year pilot behavioral support transition unit at Grey Gables. And we're also in the early stages of two new redevelopments. And so Color It will be a very strong theme and guide, as you said, the North Star, I like that, to help us make sure we're on vision as we build these programs and these bricks and mortar. As for more information, happy for people to reach out. Gray County has a website, graycounty.ca, and there's a long-term care page and contact information is there. And happy to share resources. I've benefited greatly from people sharing their resources and their ideas. And so I'm happy to share that. And, you know, there's some really great book resources out there. I mean, I love Brené Brown. I think Ellen talked about vulnerability, and I really think that that's a big piece of being authentic and genuine. And Moira and her Happily Ever Older. And I also really enjoy Being Mortal by Atul Gawande. And it's really just this look at how do we support people in living a life worth living? And what does that mean? So lots, so many opportunities to really explore how do we shift long-term care as a sector into something that we all would want to experience someday.
That's fantastic. Thank you for sharing all those resources and all those tips. Thank you.
I just want to echo what Philip said. It's just been great talking to you and hearing about ColorIt. And yes, we just wish you so much luck with the journey ahead, although you're really on the way. So it's more a matter of just, yes, follow it and keep your eye on that North Star.
No problem. Thanks so much. I'm just so honored to have been invited to. I love to tell the ColorIt story.
You have just been listening to Inspiring Impact, a special series produced by HIROC and Advantage Ontario. Today, our guest was Jennifer Cornell, Director of Long-Term Care for the County of Grey, which operates 3 long-term care homes. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for listening. You can hear more episodes of Healthcare Changemakers on our website, HIROC.com, and on your favorite podcasting apps. If you like what you hear, please rate us or post a review. Healthcare Changemakers is recorded by HIROC's communications and marketing team and produced by Podfly Productions. Follow us on Twitter at HIROC Group or email us at communications@HIROC.com. We'd love to hear from you.